rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Heir to my heart was the blood of life. Glory to his name. One more time. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood of life. Glory to his name.
Amen. All right. Please remain standing. Page 320, guys.
Soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, a life more abundant and free.
Verse 2.
Through death into life everlasting, you pass and we follow him there. Over us sin no more had dominion, for more than conquerors we turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory. His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying. His perfect salvation to tell, and turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the
be seated.
You can be seated. Both of you.
Yeah.
Hey, that's the way it is. I'm going to tell you. I've been telling people all morning that if we're going to keep up with this daylight savings thing, that we need to start a new national holiday on that Sunday, which is National Nap After Church Day. There will be napping in my household today. Good morning. Turn me down just a little bit, Dan. I'm awful powerful. You know, I don't want to blow this thing up. I saw it was snowing. Y'all know how I feel about that. So it's going to be a good morning. God knew that I hadn't had much sleep in the last like 3 days and that I'd need something to energize me today. So he sent snow. For the rest of y'all, well, you'll just have to rely on my energy. If you're here for the first time or the first time in a long time, in front of you, you'll find a welcome card. It's yellow, says welcome on it. We ask that you fill it out with as much information as you're comfortable with, and then put it in the offering plate when you leave if you don't want to talk to anybody. But if you wouldn't mind somebody talking to you just briefly. If you see Catherine, take it to Kathleen at the welcome station. We have a gift for you just for choosing to worship with us today. And what happened with that? Was my head too shiny or something? Is that, I look younger? Oh. Keep them off. But anyway, you know, it's funny because I have this like patch of hair that's like white, like on one of these sides. I don't even know what side it's on. And when you take pictures, it looks like there's no hair there. Is it right there? Yeah. And like I call it my if anybody ever watched Grey's Anatomy, I call it my McDreamy. Because why, you know what I mean? He had that white streak in his hair. But yeah. Anyway. I don't suggest watching it. I'm just saying if you ever did. Anyway, already. It's one of those days. Can't wait to get to the sermon. Take it back to Kathleen at the welcome station, and she'll give you a gift just for choosing to worship with us today. The other thing that we want to give you, if you don't have a copy of God's Word, if you don't have a Bible at home, we encourage you to take the one out of the pew in front of you. Don't worry about it. Like, don't think that we don't have more. We just got two more cases in. So we have plenty of Bibles. And as a matter of fact, if you have somebody you're witnessing to or something, you want them to have one, take it with you because we'll just replace it. Amen? You can't be that asleep. Amen? Amen? Yeah, we value God's Word here. So we want you to have that. The other thing is, when I do get into the sermon, I'll give page numbers so that it's easy to follow along, and I want you to follow along. I don't want you to take the things that I say for granted. I want you to read it for yourself, and so you can know that that's what God's Word says. Or if I'm stretching the truth, making stuff up, whatever, because I'm going to tell you, don't ever, you know, people a lot of times put a lot of trust in what pastors say. They're human. We're human. We are fallible. I'm human. Siri said, I'm not sure I understand. Of course you don't understand being a human. Daggum watches. But anywho, we want you to have a copy of God's Word, so take that. I'll be making page references later. We do have Bible studies that meet throughout the week, and they would love to have you in them on Tuesdays at 6:30 is Ladies Bible Study here at the church. They're going through the book of Philippians right now. On Wednesdays at 7 o'clock here at the church, we have a men's Bible study. And on 6:30 at 6:30 on Thursdays, Josh and Nikki Patterson host one in their home, which is at 15 Bobtail Way in Monroe, Ohio. They'll put that slide up in just a minute so you know about it and you can write it down. And then tonight at 6 o'clock, we have our youth small group meets here at the church, and that's from 6 to 7 this evening. So bring them by. It's a no-frills kind of ministry right now. In other words, we're not coming in playing game and having snacks and all that kind of. We do have snacks. We do have snacks. So, you know, we don't ever want like a kid to come and leave hungry. But we have snacks, but we don't do like the games and all that kind of stuff. We just hang out for a few minutes and then get into God's Word, and we talk through the scriptures with the kids on their level and answer any questions that they might have. And I'm going to tell you, sometimes teenagers come up with some daggone good questions. And parents, I know that it's challenging sometimes when you're raising teenagers because of the good questions that they come up with. It's okay to say, I don't know, I'll get back with you. Then go research it and come back with an honest answer, okay? Next Sunday, March 19th, is an important day on our calendar. It is our annual Let Love Grow luncheon, which is right after church in the Big Red Barn. We'll have lunch together. The church will provide the fried chicken. You bring sides and desserts and whatever it is that you want to bring. And we just fellowship and have a good time. And we call it Let Love Grow because it happens between Valentine's Day and spring. So that's the reason why we call it that. So come and be a part of that. Yes, Mark. All right. Awesome. Thank you. Something I ain't got to worry about. I always forget the drinks. I did at the last gathering. I had to hurry up and run and get some and come back. Thank you. So Sunday school is providing drinks. We're going to have those. And that's a blessing. So you just got to worry about sides and desserts. Bring what you want. Bring it to share. Amen. And if you can't bring anything, come anyway, because you're going to leave full. On March 24th, which is the following Friday, we are having our luncheon, our cookout for the teachers down at Penny Royal Elementary. And it's something that we've done several years, non-COVID years, and they really enjoy it, and we enjoy doing it. We're going to take our Blackstone Grill. We go down there and set up behind the school. We cook out for them, you know, make them some food. Give it to them so that they just come by, get it, take it to the lunchroom, and they go eat lunch. It's not like one of those things where we're going to sit there and have conversations with them and stuff like that. We don't want to interrupt their day. We just want to bless them a little bit. But one of the things that we wanted to do this time was that we wanted to take an all-hands-on-deck kind of approach. So in other words, if God has blessed you with some gift, and I don't care what it is, if it's whittling little wooden ducks, then whittle about 50 of them and you know, bring them with you, and we'll put them in a little goodie bag for the teachers. If your gift is crocheting, like we have somebody in the church that crochets, just did a bunch of beautiful little flowers. I mean, just the coolest stuff made out of crochet art. And that's really what it is art. You know, my grandma was a crochet master, and I used to watch her all the time. It's crazy. I could never do it. But use that gift for the Lord. Make some stuff. Put it in the bags for the teachers. If maybe you're like, well, I don't really have a lot of time or whatever, then cards. We would like each teacher to receive a thank you card from us that isn't just thank you and then that's it. You know what I mean? We want to tell them that we're praying for them, that we love them, that they're vital to our community, and that we appreciate them, right? And so somebody, if you know, you can just sit down and write thank you cards. You can do that. And we need 50 of those. So if I would ask that if you want to do the cards, is it all right if I have them get with you, Missy? Because she does the card ministry. So get with Missy so she can, you know, tell how many we're actually going to have and how many we need to do ourselves, that kind of thing. But whatever your gift is, if it's music, you might come and serenade them. Whatever. You know what I mean? I won't be singing behind the thing. They'll think I'm like Swedish Chef or something off of Muppets. Right? I think he was Pentecostal because he's speaking in tongues. You guys didn't get that? Mike, thank you. Thank you for laughing. Nobody else did. It's one of those days. But anyway, if you're going to come and be a part of that and you want to come help set up, we're going to need help people to help set up and to cook and serve on that day. So if you're wanting to do that and you don't have to work or whatever, 10:30 here at the church. That's where we'd ask you to meet. 10:30 here at the church, and then we're going to drive down from the church to there and begin cooking as immediately when we get there, because their lunch begins at 11:30. So we got to have food on the table ready to go at 11:30. All right? Yes. Yes. They did. So we encourage you to discontinue Amazon. No. Am I allowed to say that? Do what I want. I know it's March, and when it's March, you need to start getting in Easter mode. Easter is the Super Bowl of church. You know what I mean? That's game time. That's the time, like, you should start inviting your friends and family now for the Easter service. One of the things that we decided a few years ago was that, you know, a lot of churches do big productions on those days and stuff like that. We're not doing that. It's going to be a, you know, basically a normal church service, so people know what to expect if they come back, where the gospel's going to be presented in a way that they can understand. And then after the Easter service, We'll get together. We'll have eggs. You know, the kids can find the eggs, and there'll be prizes for that and that kind of stuff. We'll have like a little selfie booth out there so you can get a picture with your family, that kind of stuff. But other than that, it's a pretty normal day. This year, unfortunately, we will not be doing the breakfast because, you know, it's just hard. It's hard to get the breakfast together on that day of all days. In the past, the men have gotten together and cooked breakfast that morning. It's just difficult. We'll have to do it at a different time because it was always good food. And the more I talk about it, the more I'm thinking about reinstituting it. So I just want to let you all know that there's a sign-up sheet in the back for Easter, because we need help with the things that we do. Like, there's going to be a need for directed parking. Last year, parking was an issue, so we got to have some folks out there directing the parking. Mark's going to head it up, but you can work with him, and he'll set you on the right track for that. We need age group supervisors, so, you know, people that are going to be at the locations where the kids are hiding the eggs to make sure they don't murder each other to get eggs. It's like, listen, you need to be selfless and sacrificing and everything else. And then they get out there and they're like, what church? Jesus who? Give me them eggs. You know, get crazy. So there's a sign up for that. And it's on the 9th. So April 8th. On April 8th, there'll be a group that's here setting things up for the following day. So if you're available on the 8th, you can come and be a part of that setup. And then afterwards, of course, we'll need help tearing down. There's sign-up sheets in the back for that, okay? I think that's all the announcements that I have. Dan, am I good? Missy? Am I good? She stepped out. All right, everybody says I'm good. All right, then. 2 minutes.
Yep.
2 minutes to shake somebody's hand, hug their neck, tell them you're glad to see them. 2 minutes on the clock. Get up. I know you don't want to move, but you need to so you don't fall asleep when I'm preaching. Morning. How are you?
Voices on. Everyone who longs for truth, needing hope and strength renewed, come and meet the Savior of the world. Everyone who longs inside, desperate for the words of life, come and meet the Savior of your soul.
Everyone who lives in Christ died to self and raised to life. Come and praise the Savior of the world. Everyone who perseveres, faith will overcome all fears. Come and praise the Savior of your soul.
The one.
saves, he reigns forever. Oh, my soul, lift up your praise, I will rise and bless the Lord. Oh, my soul, lift up the name of the one who saves, he reigns forever.
Thank you.
All right. It like turned on, then back off, then on, back off. John chapter 3 is where we're at. John chapter 3, and everybody's like, yes, John 3:16, I know that one. We're not going to get there today. Just a heads up, there's too much before that. Page 983 in the Big Blue Bible, 983. Dan, I still feel like I'm a little loud out here. And with as tired as I am, I'm bound to get excited. Just being honest. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll get started. Heavenly Father, I thank you for these hymns and for these folks who were willing to get up after a night of less sleep, dust the snow off their cars, and come to worship you and to be filled. Lord, I pray that you do that today. I pray that you fill us up. Lord, the scriptures that we're going to get into are just so powerful and so universe-altering that, Lord, I just pray that you have your way with us. Lord, that whatever preconceived notions and traditions and, you know, natural bents and all that we bring to the scriptures, Lord, I pray that we would just lay that to the side and let your discernment work in us. Let your spirit work in us and give us discernment as we get into your word. Lord, I pray that anything that would block us from receiving what it is that you have for us, whether it be outside influences or something that we've carried in from the outside, Lord, I pray that you tear down those walls and that your word would penetrate us all the way to the core of who we are. Lord, I just pray that when we leave here today, we have a clear understanding of what your gospel is so that we can take it and carry it out to the world as you instructed us. We love you and we thank you for your word and we thank you for your spirit and we thank you for being one of us and paying for the penalty of sin so that we could be part of your kingdom. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. So, we're going to begin in John chapter 3 today. And we're going to make it till about verse 15, to be quite frank. And we're just going to get started right from the top. We're going to read God's Word. We're going to come back and we're going to talk about God's Word, stop where it's appropriate, and explain things. How we generally do approach the Scriptures. So, John chapter 3, page 983 in the Big Blue Bible. It says in verse 1, "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do the signs that you do unless God is with him.' Jesus answered him, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.' Nicodemus said to him, 'How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?' Jesus answered, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, 'How can these things be?' Jesus answered him, 'Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not know, you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descends from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life.'" Now, the first thing that I want to point out is this Nicodemus fella, right? So basically, there was this group of people called the Sadducees, of which Nicodemus is one. And in that group of people consisted of about 70 people that were rabbis, various leaders in the community that had a spiritual background, a religious background, right? These, there are some later that are mentioned that the Bible talks about in favorable terms. One of them is a fellow by the name of Joseph of Arimathea. If you know of the story of the death and resurrection of Jesus, then you know that he allowed his tomb that he paid for to be used for the burial of Christ. And in that story, Nicodemus comes and helps. So there's Nicodemus shows up in the scriptures again as well. The other thing is, there's a rabbi called Gamaliel, who's a famous rabbi. One of Paul was one of his students. Yeah, I was looking for that word. I was going to say prodigy, and then I was like, I don't know that he was a prodigy. But he's one of his students, right? So the Sadducees, their job was that they would get together and they would make rulings on religious matters. That's one of the things that they would do. So if you, you know, were afraid that dragging a chair across a dirt floor on the Sabbath would constitute work, then you might go to these people and ask, is this a violation of the Sabbath? Or if you wanted to put one over on your neighbor, you could ask it about them, you know, which they did that stuff too. And so they acted as a religious standard, you know. They created the standards, them and the Pharisees. The other thing that they served as was kind of like a civil court for civil matters under the Roman authority. Right? The Romans didn't want to be bothered with the day-to-day, you know, activities of the people that they were occupying or that they had conquered. So in this case, like in other cases, they would allow them to kind of govern themselves. And they used the Sadducees in order to do that. That's one of the things that the Sadducees did. So this guy, Nicodemus, comes from that line. He is a learned man. He is a teacher of the Jews. Amen? Everybody following along? Later on, when Jesus is put to trial, guess who's the ones that put him to trial? Sadducees. Right? And you're like, well, there were some good men that spoke favorably about him that were on that assembly. Yeah, 3 out of 70. if they were all three there. You know what I mean? So, you think they're going to have any sway? Probably not. Not with a body that size. Right? So, I want to point out a few things. The first thing that I want to point out is that when Nicodemus comes to Jesus, look at what he says. He says, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." Now, Nicodemus is making an honest but true mistake about who Jesus is. What's the mistake? He's identifying as a rabbi, right? So in other words, he's coming to him, he's like, "Rabbi to rabbi, let's have this little talk." You know what I mean? Rabbi to rabbi. He's identifying him as a rabbi, which is on the surface seemingly a good thing, right? And he even acknowledges that the only way that Jesus could do the things that he does is if God's with him. But he doesn't go so far as to understand who Jesus is yet. Because who is Jesus? Is he merely a rabbi? Is he merely a teacher? No. He's God in the flesh. Amen? So that's the fundamental mistake that Nicodemus has in his mind when he comes to Jesus. I'm going to take a minute to thank God that Jesus didn't turn him away and just say, "You don't understand, get out of here." You know what I mean? He took a minute to teach him. I'm thankful that our Savior took a little time with the rabbi, with Nicodemus. The other thing that you notice is that he came at night, and there's a bunch of different explanations as to why he came at night. Some said it was in fear, right? Because he didn't want to get caught coming and talking to Jesus, because he's, you know, that would give him, if Jesus was not of God, and somebody saw a Sadducee going and talking and having a conversation with Jesus, it would give him some status, some authority. You know what I mean? Like the same thing in politics. You notice for a long time, nobody would ever go over and have a conversation with the leader of North Korea. No president would be seen dead doing that. Right? Why? Because they didn't want to legitimize what that leader was doing over there. Right? You guys know what I'm talking about? This is how it works. Yes. No. Right? I just want to know that you're following along. The same thing would have happened here. So if Jesus was not of God, and Nicodemus would have been seen going to him, then it would have legitimized his ministry in some way, and that would look bad on the Sadducees. The other thing is, because of Jesus' message, if he's seen talking to Jesus and legitimizing Jesus' ministry because of what Jesus is saying, it looks bad on the Sadducees later on, right? Which is why they put him to trial. So that's one theory. One of the theories is one of the explanations, not, I guess it's a theory, but one of the explanations is that he comes at night for fear of being seen. Another explanation that some people have used, and I don't really lean toward this one, but there is some symbolism that's going on, and that is that you know, people tend sometimes to just over-spiritualize the Bible. How do you overly spiritualize something that is of the Spirit? You know, so there's some justification for it, but they say, well, Nicodemus came at the night of his faith. You know what I mean? Like he was in the darkness. It symbolizes that he comes in the darkness to the light, right? And that may be something, you know, I'm fine with that. But at the same time, I just like what the Scripture says. It just tells us that he came at night. Amen? He came at night. There might be a totally practical explanation, and that is that, yeah, it was because of fear. It also could have been because that was the time when he knew he could have audience with him for an extended period. You know what I mean? Could be something that simple. But he did come at night, and he didn't know yet that Jesus was the one who all of his study, all of his research, all of it leading up to this point was about the one whom he is talking with. It's all about Jesus. That's what they were studying. That's what they were looking for. They were looking for the Messiah, and the Messiah is standing in front of him. He knew that he was of God, but he didn't yet know that he is God. And I'm going to tell you that a lot of people get stuck right there. The world does, in a lot of ways.
You have a bunch of people who acknowledge that Jesus is of God. They don't acknowledge him as God. Amen? That leads to all sorts of problems. As a matter of fact, the Bible even tells us about those problems. It describes them. It says that there are people who claim to know God but deny his power. Right? They say things like, Jesus was a good teacher. Not really. I mean, because if he's not who he says he is, if he's not God, then he's a liar. And a liar is not a good teacher. Amen? Amen. If he's mistaken, or if he's nuts, a lunatic is also not a good teacher. You know what I mean? He can't be a good teacher unless he is who he says he is. Amen? So sometimes the world makes the mistake of listening to his teachings, acknowledging that he couldn't do the things that he did, he couldn't say the things that he said, unless there was something else behind it. But they don't go so far as to say, he's God. That's what Nicodemus about to get schooled on, amen? He wanted to talk to him rabbi to rabbi, but he wasn't talking to Jesus rabbi to rabbi. He was talking to Jesus rabbi to God's own son. Amen? And what did Jesus say? He said, he came to him and he said, we know that you're a teacher come from God, for no one can do the signs unless God is with him. And then verse 3, Jesus answered him. What did he say? He said, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And that statement is so revolutionary, it throws Nicodemus so far off whack, he's like, got him. This dude's nuts. Am I supposed to go back into my mom's womb? Can a grown man be born again? Now, I want to tell you something when it comes to this word, born again. It means exactly that, to be born again. But it also can mean, and a literal phrasing, I guess, would be born from above. Born from above. And when you read it as born from above, born again from above, you know, then that kind of gives it the weight of what Jesus is saying and why Nicodemus is so thrown off by it. Notice the thing that Nicodemus doesn't do. He knows that Jesus isn't talking about like reincarnation. You know what I mean? He doesn't say that. You know what I mean? Like, oh, so we'll die and then we're going to be born again. He doesn't say that, does he? He says that, how can someone as a grown man enter back into his mom's womb and be born again? So he knows that Jesus isn't talking about something as crazy as like reincarnation. And what Jesus is like, no, what I'm telling you is much crazier. Amen? It's much crazier. It's much more outlandish because it's true. It's a new concept that he just can't get his mind around. Why? Why can't he get his mind around it? Well, I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to give you a little spoiler alert, right? And that is that Nicodemus is stuck in fleshly thinking. He's stuck in carnal thinking. Now, when we talk about, you know, Jesus even says at the end, he's like, the stuff of the flesh is flesh and stuff of the spirit is spirit, you know, that kind of thing, right? This idea of this paradox, this dichotomy, the flesh and the spirit, right? Being in the flesh means that instead of looking to God, we're looking to the circumstances around us. Now think of the circumstances that Nicodemus finds himself in. After 400 years of God's silence, right? There's this man doing these things that they ain't seen in a long time. There's a guy that's dressed in animal hair, right? Eating bugs, locusts, and, you know, honey, and baptizing people, you know, leading people to repentance down at the Jordan with John the Baptist. Like, that stuff's happening now. But he's so focused on the circumstances in which he finds himself, you know, the period The Pharisees abusing God's law for personal gain and throwing chains on people that aren't even supposed to be there. This is an obviously pretty good dude. So is Joseph of Arimathea, right? They're obviously pretty good dudes, right? But they're in this system that does nothing but spiritually oppress people all day, every day. And that's all he has seen for all of his life. So I imagine it would be hard to look past the flesh and see the spirit. Amen? The other thing is, his whole understanding of what the Spirit does and who the Spirit is, all of it is different than what is getting ready to come. He doesn't understand it. He just doesn't see it. And what does Jesus say? He's like, all right then, let me give it to you in simpler terms, terms that you're going to understand, right? And then he says to him that you have to be born of the water and of the Spirit. Now that phrase right there, that you have to be born of the water, that's a source of contention amongst Christians. A lot of debate goes on about that phrase. There are five possible interpretations of being born of the water. And because I like transparency, I'm going to give them all to you. And I'm going to tell you which one I think makes sense. The first explanation is that the water means natural birth. Now, I have six kids. I witnessed the birth of five of them, right? I've seen some babies come into the world. And what's like the first thing that happens when labor gets started? The water breaks. Yeah, we're born in fluid. Amen? As a matter of fact, when Olivia was born, Ashley's water had broken, and there was this Asian doctor that came in. Dr. Song was his name. And this dude had been delivering babies. I mean, he may have been delivering babies at the time of Christ. Like, he's been around a while. Like, he knows we old dude. And they start freaking out because they notice that Olivia's upside down, right? Not upside down, feet first, upside like the wrong way. So Ashley's water had already broke and stuff. And if you don't know about the birthing process, this is probably more education than you want. But I'm telling you, because it's a beautiful miracle of God. And so, you know, everybody's freaking out. Ashley had already like at one point she crashed. Like, I mean, she turned white, unresponsive, like everything. And I'm sitting there holding Brenna, who's crying. And, you know, she's like two at the time. And she's like, Mommy, okay? And I'm like, yeah, everything. I'm lying to her, you know, because I'm scared to death. My buddy came up, who doesn't have any kids of his own, doesn't know what to do with kids. But he knew it was tragic enough that he needed to come up and take her off my hands so I could focus on Ashley. Doctors swarming everywhere, you know, whole nine yards. So then this happens. She's about to give the birth. And Olivia's upside down. She's facing the wrong direction. Water had already broken. So it's time for the baby's got to come out. And everybody's kind of like whirlwind nuts in that moment. And this old Dr. Song walks in just as cool as a cucumber. You know what I mean? Like didn't nothing, wasn't, I mean, it put me at ease just watching him walk in. Because I'm like, this cat knows what he's doing. So he comes in, and this is an amazing thing that they did. He had them pump the fluid, the water, back into her. And then he patiently, beautifully, subtly, with a master's hand, started to massage Olivia's head ever so slightly. Just talking to me as if nothing in the world's going on. Like, he does this every day. I'm sitting there in freak out mode. But his words, even, I mean, he just calmly just does that for a little while. And what he was doing, and I didn't know it, was every time he massaged her little head, that head turned. And there's something about the human body that most of us know, and that is wherever the head goes, the body follows. So he literally turned her over just by massaging her head. That water was extremely important. Amen? So that's one explanation. One explanation is that when it says that you got to be born of the water and of the Spirit, that it's natural birth that it's referring to. Now, some people read this and they're like, well, that's kind of a, like, why would Jesus even say that? Because anybody who has heard it, anybody who would hear it, has obviously been naturally born. Amen? That's a legitimate criticism. The second thing, the second explanation. This one, to me, is the one that's probably the most stretch. It's the biggest stretch. And that is that the explanation is that the water, you have to be born of the water and of the Spirit, the water means the Word. And the reason why they say this is because in Ephesians chapter 5, when it's talking about, you know, sometimes we don't read that because it says things that we don't understand, and if we don't understand it, we don't like it, you know, where it says, like, wives, be subject to your own husbands. Everybody's like, what? Well, don't start reading there. Read the verse before. In verse 21, it says, therefore, subject yourselves one to another. Right? And then it says, wives, be subject to your own husband. And it goes in and it talks about the relationship between the husband and wife, right? And how the relationship with the husband and wife is the analogy that Jesus uses to describe the church. Like, the church is his bride. Amen? Ephesians chapter 5 is where it tells that. In verse 26, it says that there's a cleansing, right, for sanctification purposes, of the water, the Word. There will be a cleansing of water with the Word, right? So they take these things and they say, okay, water means Word. So we go back to John chapter 3. It means that the water means the Word. So you have to be baptized by the Word and the Spirit. Like I said, that one's a stretch. If you're understanding, like if you're practicing propical, what kind of word is that? I put two words together. My brain's catching up. Proper hermeneutics or hermeneutical approach, you know, taking proper hermeneutical approach, then that's the one for me that is the biggest stretch. Okay? The third possible explanation of born of the water is that baptism is an essential part of salvation. And so it's saying that you must be baptized with water, baptism, and the Spirit. This is the one that I don't even entertain. Here's why I don't even entertain it. Because there are other scriptures that directly dispute that. That say that salvation is by faith alone. Amen? So if salvation is by faith alone, then how can it also be about a work like baptism? It can't. Here's some scriptures that refute it, I believe, directly. John 3:16, John 3:36, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, Titus 3:5. Salvation is by faith alone. So, the other thing is, you know, it could be alluding to baptism, which I'll get to in a minute, which is why there's the confusion. I'll get to that in just a second. Number four is some people believe that when it says water, that can be translated as Spirit. And so Jesus is just being redundant, saying you have to be baptized of the Spirit and of the Spirit. That don't fly with me. I don't think that that's true. I don't see any evidence of that. I think that Jesus is making an earthly analogy, like he's explaining spiritual things in earthly terms for the benefit of the listener, which he explains at the end. If you don't understand earthly things, how can I tell you about heavenly things, right? So I don't think that's the case. Here to me, number one is very likely to me, number one and number five. Number five, I really like because it has historical background, and this is what I mean. The fifth way that you can interpret the born of the water is that it's referring to John's baptism, but it's referring to it in terms of repentance. So then what Jesus is saying is that you have to repent in order to be baptized by the Spirit. So there has to be repentance for regeneration. Now, that would make some sense. The reason why it would make some sense is what did we just read about? John's baptism. Amen? That was well known, widely known. Everybody knew about it, knew what was going on, that he was down there baptizing them. What was he baptizing them for? He was baptizing them as a symbol of their repentance. Amen? So it could be that it is referring to baptism, but it's talking about the baptism of repentance and saying that in order for you to be saved, to be baptized in the Spirit, to be regenerated, to be born again, you have to be born of repentance, right? Turning away from the world, dying to self, so that you can be regenerated. So that works for me too. Amen? That's consistent with the Scriptures. I don't have any problem with that. The most likely, to me, is the first explanation that is talking about a natural birth. Right? Okay, so what Jesus did was he just gave Nicodemus the gospel. Amen? Well, that's what he did. Right? You got to be born, you know, of the water. And I love it. I hope he is talking about repentance. I hope one day somebody finds a smoking gun in some translation from long ago and they're like, here it is, look. Repent, you know, because that's consistent with everything else Jesus says throughout the Scriptures, before and after. Amen? Repent. And if you repent, then you'll be born from above. Do you see what I mean? If you repent, you'll be baptized, you'll be born of the Spirit. You'll be born of from above. Do you see what I mean? That's how you become part of God's kingdom. Amen? And one of the things that I always say is everybody, you know, this new age stuff, they're like, we're all God's children. No, we're not. You were born into this world, but you didn't die to it. I'm dead to the self and born in the kingdom of God. Amen? I'm a child of the King. He told me how to become one. And that's to be born in Him. To be born again. Amen? So what does that tell us? Very simply. You want to take another point? You want to take notes? Whatever. You must be born again. Isn't that simple enough? You must be born again. Then, after that explanation, you know, Jesus gets into this, you know, it seems like it's like what is he saying here? You know, it's like one of those kinds of things. It says, the wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound. This is verse 8. But you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Now, here's one of those things in Greek that is kind of hard for us to grasp in English. And that is this word pneuma. I got to look it up because I don't speak Greek. Amen? It's P-N-E-U-M-A. Pneuma. Right? Yeah, there it is. Now, that word, pneuma, means wind, but it also means spirit, right? It means wind and spirit, not like wind combined with the spirit. It means sometimes you can use that word to mean the wind, and other times you can use that word to mean the spirit. Amen? That makes this make much more sense, right? And this is what Jesus is saying. The spirit is like the wind. In that, do you control it? No. Some people, like I told somebody this morning, I had Taco Bell the other day. We're not talking about that kind of wind. And if anybody's had Taco Bell, you know you don't control that either. Right? You don't. I'm trying, all right? I'm trying. But you don't control the wind. You're not the one who tells the wind to get started or where to stop or sends it on its path or even knows its path. Amen? We have tools that we can see, like, where it's coming from, right, at a given moment. right? We can throw some grass up in the air and see that it's heading that direction, but we don't really know where it comes from. We don't really know where it's going to stop. Amen? We misunderstand the wind a lot, but we don't control the wind. That's what Jesus is saying here. Here's the deal with the Spirit. The Spirit does what the Spirit wants. There ain't a thing you can do to stop it. Amen? I'm thankful for that. You know why I'm thankful for that? Because in a world that's constantly drifting apart, away from God, away from His teachings, away from morality and all that kind of stuff, at any given moment, that wind can blow. Amen? See, that's hope, right? That's what I was talking with the men on Wednesday night, and we're sitting around talking about how when you read the book of Ezekiel, it describes almost perfectly United States today. Almost perfectly. And so we're talking about that, and I'm listening to the room, and there's a lot of, you know, like this is bad. We're in a bad place. It's getting worse. It's going to be worse, you know, all this kind of stuff. But everybody feels that, amen? Everybody knows that. The whole world feels it right now. That it's worse today than it was a few days ago. And guess what? In a few more days, it's going to be worse than today. We feel that. We know that. So in a world when it's like that, when it's all doom and gloom, and it's all bad news all the time, where's our hope? It's in Jesus. Because at any moment, that wind begins to blow. We don't control it, right? So what do? We get baptized. We get born in the Spirit. Amen? So then when we're born of the Spirit, we are of the Spirit, which means you're on the same team as the very wind. Amen? So then that Spirit can blow through you. Amen? I hear all these stuff. People misunderstand the Spirit so much. It makes for a lot of confusion. Amen? Like we see all these things that are happening right now, people, you know, describing. I read a story the other day where they talked about, you know, that they knew revival had begun because they could hear the wind blowing through the auditorium. And I'm like, you sure the AC just didn't kick on? You know what I mean? Like, do I expect to hear rushing wind when the Spirit's working? No, I don't control it. He can do whatever he wants. If he wants to do that, that's fine, right? I see them say things like when they describe the Spirit, they say, fire fall on me, and I know what they're referring to. They're talking about Pentecost and that, you know, how the Spirit fell and fire and all that, you know, I get it. And they talk about the wind of the Spirit coming in and just blowing people over. You ever seen that on TV where they just like, those go, and just people just fall over. Like, that's not what Jesus is talking about. Amen? You say, well, you can't put your limits on the Spirit. I'm like, no. God put His own limits, and He said, I'm not the author of confusion. God did that. I didn't. Here's what I know. That if you are born of the water, naturally born or repentance, I don't care which one. If you are repentant, and you are born of the Spirit, you are regenerated a new person in Christ. On the side of the Spirit. That's a beautiful thing. Why? Because the gospel, the thing that we have, right? We're supposed to be broadcasters of that gospel. We're supposed to cast that seed to the wind and then let the wind carry it. The pneuma wind carry it. You see what I mean? So then that makes sense when we understand that. He keeps talking. He says, verse 9, Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? Right? That's a genuine question. How can this be? I don't understand it. Like, that's what he's saying. How is this possible? Right? How can these things be? And Jesus said, are you the teacher of Israel and yet you do not understand these things? You're the one who is learned. You're the one who's read the book. You're the one who knows. You're the one that the people come to for answers, and you can't see it? Truly, I say to you, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you don't receive our testimony. Like, we're telling you, but you don't receive it. You won't believe it because of that, because you don't understand. Even though you are the one who is learned, you are the one who is the teacher, you're the one who's supposed to have the answers, but we're telling you that the answers are right in front of your face. Then Jesus said, if I told you earthly things and you didn't believe those, how can you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? Listen, when Jesus has this conversation with Nicodemus, he's telling him, you got to be born again. First of all, that's gospel 101. That's elementary understanding of who Jesus is, right? That's the elementary, the foundational thing. And he even puts it in these terms of like earthly things, like being born and wind, so that Nicodemus can understand, and he still can't understand. Why? Because sometimes our carnality keeps us from seeing the things of God. It keeps us from seeing what God said would happen, happen. Our flesh, that's another word for it. So when I use this word carnality, think of flesh. Amen? That keeps us from understanding the things of God. Nicodemus should have known. Why? Because he was given the Old Testament. He's given the Old Testament. God literally told them of the things that he's speaking of to Nicodemus right now in the Word. In Isaiah chapter 32 and verse 95, it speaks of a time when the Spirit is poured out upon us and the wilderness becomes a fruitful field. In Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse 25, it says, I will sprinkle clean water on you and you shall be clean. Joel chapter 2 and verse 28, it says, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. He told them over and over and over again in the Old Testament that this is what's coming. But they were so stuck in the flesh that they couldn't even see it when it's right in front of them. He couldn't see it because he was focused on his circumstances. He couldn't see it because he was focused on his tradition. He couldn't see it because he couldn't get out of his own daggone way. Everybody sit back and we look at Nicodemus. We're like, don't you get it, dummy? It's right there. Right? And I'm saying the same thing to us. You know what I mean? You can't judge poor Nicodemus, start pointing fingers at him. You got three pointing back at you. Right? How many times we let ourselves, our tradition, our flesh, our circumstances get in the way of seeing the things of God unfold right in front of us. He does it all the time. All the time. You're like, well, Josh, you can't just attribute everything to God. Yes, I can. You know why? Because he's sovereign. There's nobody that rules beside him. There's just him. Amen? Ain't nobody beside him. He's sovereign. If it happens, God allowed it. That's why proper doctrine is important. He was stuck in the flesh. He wasn't in the Spirit. That was his deal. He was used to seeing the oppression by the Romans and being occupied by that, God being silent and the Pharisees abusing God's law and for their own benefit and all that kind of stuff. He's used to seeing all that kind of stuff. And when you're used to, when you're in that mode and you're in that mode your whole life, hard to get out of it. Amen? Literally talking to the Son of God, and he can't understand these earthly analogies of water, wind, and Spirit. When how is he ever going to tell him about things of heaven? You know what I mean? Because Jesus knows the things of heaven. You know why he knows? Because that's where he came from. And that's where he's going back to. Amen? Which makes sense when we read the next part. What does it say? Where did I leave off? In verse 13, no one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven. Did you see? And then he says, the Son of Man. Listen to what he's like giving Nicodemus a clue. Amen? He just said, If you can't understand earthly things, how am I going to tell you heavenly things? Well, how could he even tell him heavenly things? The only way he could tell him of heavenly things is if he's ascended, you know, to heaven. If he's already been there, amen? And then he says, the only one who ascends and descends is the Son of Man. What is he telling him? That's me. Right? That's literally what's going on. And then he tells him this story, and it's a peculiar story. And it's one of those stories that some of you may not even know about in the Old Testament. I'd like you to turn your Bible. First of all, let's see how Jesus says it in verse 14. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. I want you to turn your Bible to the book of Numbers, chapter 21. In the big blue Bible, it's page 143. Numbers chapter 21. We're going to start reading in verse 4. And this is what it says. From Mount Hor, they set out, by the way, to the Red Sea, to go around the land of Edom. And the people became impatient on the way. Imagine that. Sometimes the children of Israel is like riding with your kids to Texas. You know what I mean? Are we there yet? Can we stop? I'm thirsty, you know. Are we ever going to eat? You know, all these things. That's how, like, petulant children. And then we're all like, yeah, they are. And I'm like, no, we are. Amen. That's how you read the Bible. It says, and the people became impatient on the way. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food. You see that? When are we going to eat? And no water. I'm so thirsty. And we loathe this worthless food. Now hold on just a second. You said there's no food, and then you're going to call it worthless. It's like God just needs to just, you know, get a voice from heaven to say, don't eat it. You'll starve. Just like my mom used to say. You know what I mean? This is what's for dinner. Don't eat it, you starve. When you get hungry enough, you eat just about anything. Amen? We loathe this worthless food. Then the Lord, look at this. Now, I want you to see those first words. Then the Lord sent. Did you see that? The Lord sent. The reason why I want to point that out is because the next thing that comes, a lot of times, we're going to attribute this to the devil. But it doesn't say the devil sent. Amen? It says the Lord sent. What did he send? Fiery serpents among the people. What? Fiery snakes. I'm going to tell you something. If I'm there and I'm in those people, I'd be like, no, this food's great. You know, I love this food, Lord. You know, keep those snakes away from me, right? That should be enough, amen? Fiery serpents, he sent them. That's awesome. I hate snakes. The only good snake's a dead one. Then the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people so that many, hold on, did I read that right? So that many people of Israel died. These fiery snakes are poisonous fiery snakes. Right? And the people came to Moses and they said, we have sinned, We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that he may take away the serpents from us. So Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said to Moses, make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole. And everyone who is bitten, when he sees it, shall live. So Moses made a bronze serpent and set it on a pole. And if a serpent bit anyone, he would look at the bronze serpent and live. That's the story. So you got these snakes that are a judgment from God for their sin. Amen? So that's one of the reasons why it says fiery serpents, right? Because fire represents God's judgment a lot in the Bible. And it's God's judgment coming down on them to remind them who God is. Amen? And they're like, Moses, pray for us. He's like, okay, I'll go talk to God. God says, listen, this is what I want you to do. I want you to make one of them serpents. And I want you to put it on a pole. What's the purpose of putting it on a pole? Because I'm going to tell you something. Not all ground is flat. Amen? So if I am, you know, far away from the pole and it ain't lifted up, then I may never see it. Amen? So you got to lift that thing up where people can see it no matter where they're at. And if they get bit by the snakes, they just look at the pole and then they live. Amen? So look at what Jesus says again, John chapter 3. Now that we know that. And it says, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. What is Jesus telling Nicodemus? He says, listen, I can tell you about heavenly things. I can tell you about heavenly things, in other words, because I've been there. And there's only one who's ever been there, and that's the Son of Man. The only one that goes up and comes down, that's the Son of Man. And I just told you that I came down. He can't connect the dots right here. I mean, he might, because later on he shows up and he's like helping out, right? But there's dots to be connected. Okay. So what Jesus is saying is he can tell about heavenly things because he's been there. You know, he goes back and forth. The only one that goes back and forth is the Son of Man. And then he tells him, this is God's plan. This is what is coming. That Son of Man has to be lifted up just like the snake was, the bronze serpent in the wilderness. And anybody who looked at that serpent that was lifted up between heaven and earth, their lives were saved. But anyone who believes on this Son of Man that's going to be lifted up, they don't just get to live. They get to live forever. That's the gospel of Jesus. Amen? There is no other name. There is no other name by which you can be saved. It's just Jesus. Why? Because he was lifted up just like that bronze serpent was. Amen? So, this to me is like the first complete telling of the gospel in the scripture, right? Where it's like, here it is, start to finish. This is how it's going to plan out. That in order for you to become part of the kingdom of God, you have to become a new person. You have to be born again, right? And the way for you to live forever is to believe on the Son of Man who's been lifted up for all to see. That's the gospel. That's the thing that we respond to with our lives. That's like when we are repenting of our sin and turning away from it, that's the thing we turn to is Jesus. Amen? To the Son of Man that was lifted up between heaven and earth, just like the serpent in the wilderness. Like that's what we're turning to when we turn away from our sin, when we repent. And when you do that, and when that happens, that you repent of your sin, you turn away from it, and you follow Christ, you believe on Him, then you are given eternal life. That's hope. See, there were a whole lot of people that were in the midst of those serpents, you know, hating the food that they did have, thirsty, complaining, impatient, looking around at the serpents and, oh, it's all lost. We're all going to die. But in the midst of that, God still offered hope. Amen? I saw this dude made a video online, and I just want to refute what he said in case you run into it. He said, that was a violation of the second commandment. You're not supposed to make any graven images. Then God told Noah or Moses to make a graven image and hold it up, you know. Well, here's the thing. When it's talking about graven images, it's talking about to be worshipped. Did they worship the bronze serpent? That's not what it said. It said they looked at it. Amen? God ain't going to violate his own commands. It's just that simple. Amen? He worked within the framework that he already set to provide hope. And that's what Nicodemus is getting in this moment. Here's the framework. You've seen it. You've been looking for a Messiah. Here he is. Amen? Here's your hope. That's our hope. Easter's coming. Amen? You got a lot of people in your life that don't know the gospel. Right? If you don't know how to speak it, it's real simple. Let me show you a story in the Bible. Numbers chapter 21. Now let me show you what Jesus says about that. Right? You believe on him, you have eternal life. Repent of your sin. Be born again. And become part of the kingdom. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, first I want to thank you for the energy to get through today, to deliver that message, which I believe is your message. Lord, so many times we just overcomplicate things. We don't see clearly the picture that you lay out before us because we're so focused on the things that are around us, about our history, about our tradition, about how we've always been taught, all those things that we bring to the table. Lord, I pray that you would remove those things and let us just look to you. Because in times like these, when it seems like there is very little hope, where there's nothing to really, where we have trouble celebrating because we see the decline and where the world's going, Lord, at any moment we know that your spirit can blow and revive it. So we pray that you do that in us. Lord, that you would revive our hearts. So that we would go out and give out this gospel freely and clearly, that we wouldn't be ashamed of it, Lord, that we would tell those who really are hopeless because they don't have you about how to have you. Lord, the ones that are dead in their sin, that are walking around just breathing to death, Lord, I pray that we would be so bold as to offer them life that you have offered to all. All we have to do is just look on you and believe on you. You've made it so easy in that regard. But it's so difficult because we've got to turn away from everything that we've ever known. We have to turn away from our sin. We have to turn away from the flesh nature. We have to turn away from the world and from ourselves and turn to you. And Lord, that's hard sometimes. But Lord, that's also why, if we do that with our lives, if we decide to follow you, if we turn from our wickedness, if we repent of our sin and we turn to you, then your word says that your grace and your mercy, your loving kindness, they follow us around all day, every day. So that in the times that we stumble, we stub our toe, we fall, we start looking back to the world, we start turning back to the old self, Lord, that we have the ability, because of your power, to be convicted, to repent, and to turn back to you. Your grace, your mercy, allow us to do that. And I love you for it. I thank you for that, Lord, because I'm one that needs a lot of it. And you know that. Lord, I pray that each one of us would constantly keep our eyes focused on you, the one who was lifted up, and the one that in whom, if we believe, we have eternal life. Let us focus on that, not the snakes that are around us. Not the treacherous world that we live in. The pitfalls. Let us not focus on those things. Not focus on the sin that we turn away from, but instead focus on you, the solution. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing.
came sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so Jesus Messiah.